Hi, I'm Allison Beard, an editor at HBR, and I'm here today with Sydney Finkelstein, a professor at the Tuck School at Dartmouth and author of the book Superbosses, as well as a related HBR article. Sydney, thank you so much for coming in.
Great to talk to you, Allison.
So let me start by asking, what is a superboss?
Superboss is someone who helps other people get better. They spawn tremendous amount of talent. It's kind of like if you look in an industry and you see this one person that so many people have worked for, who is that person? How is it that that person has trained so much talent? That's a superboss.
And how did you start studying them?
You know, I'm a foodie and I got interested in the chef business, and I looked at Alice Waters as, you know, the famous chef from Chef Panisse and Restaurateur, and she really created the farm-to-table organic food movement. And I started looking at all the different people that came through a restaurant that worked for her, and it became the who's who of American restaurants. And you start to look at that and you say, wow, how did one person have this incredible influence in the development of that industry? Just kind of following intuitive methods and kind of things took off from there.
And who else did you study?
Well, I studied a lot of different people. Bill Walsh is a great example, you know, the former coach of the San Francisco 49ers. You go look at his former assistant coaches, and they've gone on to become head coaches throughout the NFL. In fact, 2015, 20 out of the 32 head coaches all worked at one point for Bill Walsh.
Wow, that's amazing.
It's amazing.
Yeah. And so what do these super bosses do that sort of mere mortal managers don't?
Well, they certainly are especially good at identifying unusual talent. Mm-hmm. And for example, they really care about certain metrics that maybe not every manager or leader cares about. I'm thinking about extreme intelligence, creativity, and tremendous flexibility. Mm-hmm. You know, for example, Norman Brinker, who started many restaurant chains, casual food restaurant business, he had many people that he helped develop. And one of his proteges that I interviewed said, you know, Norman was always looking for not just the guy that could play first base, but the guy that could be a ball player, could play any position. He wanted people you could move around to all kinds of different places.
Mm-hmm. And how do they find these unusual talents?
Well, they're looking in unusual places as well. Okay. So for example, of course, you look at credentials, you look at standard processes, but they're always on the lookout. They're kind of like talent spotters. So for example, Tommy Frist, who was the longtime CEO of Hospital Corporation of America, he saw this tremendous potential in someone who was a physical therapist. Mm-hmm. And he gave her an opportunity, and that became a pathway to the C-suite. Or you go to Bill Walsh again, and he created the first minority coaching program for assistant coaches in the NFL. Many of those people that went through that program ended up becoming head coaches. So looking for talent in all kinds of places is really what they're all about.
Right. And what about developing that talent once they have it? How do they turn these people who are, you know, very intelligent, creative, flexible, how do they turn them into stars like they are?
Yeah, they do a lot of different things. You know, the idea of raising expectations on people, that's not that unusual. Everyone's in a 24/7 world these days, but they add something else, and that is they inspire them. They make people believe that they are the chosen ones, that they're the ones that could accomplish anything. Ralph Lauren used to say to his team, "We are the ones everybody else is following." They watch what we're doing, and then they try to follow what we're doing. We set the standard. So what they're really doing is they're instilling this tremendous sense of confidence in people. And, you know, confidence is a prerequisite to greatness. Any way you look at it. That's one of the big things that they do.
Right. But when you set high expectations, how do you make sure that people meet them?
Well, they're tough taskmasters. They certainly expect you to perform. They work closely with you. It's not like they just delegate big jobs and they just let you do it, which they will delegate, but they also will roll up their sleeves and work with you. I use the analogy of the master and apprentice in the book. They are masters for these apprentices. And think about, you know, that idea. Where has that gone, the idea of an apprenticeship? We don't even use that term anymore. But in fact, these super bosses have resurrected that. And by that, I really mean big-time jobs, delegation, but working hand-in-hand sometimes to work together to accomplish what needs to be done.
Without micromanaging?
Well, they get close to that line. This is something a lot of people don't recognize. Most people, I think, they look at delegation on one side and the opposite is micromanagement. And I don't think that's accurate. I think there's two things going on at the same time. You could be a big delegator and not a big delegator. You could be a big micromanager and you could be a borderline micromanager. They're not necessarily the same type of thing. And so as a result, what superbosses do is they combine these things in what many people will say is unusual. Big-time delegators, and I'm going to say borderline, not quite, borderline micromanagers. They're willing to roll up their sleeves and work with people.
Yeah. So we've talked about hiring practices. We've talked about development practices. Is there a certain leadership style that all of these bosses have?
Well, they're great innovators. They're innovators in their own businesses. And they adopt all kinds of innovative practices when it comes to how to manage people, how to develop talent. But in terms of overall leadership style, they have different personalities. Some are really, really tough. Others are more nurturing and supportive. Others, I call them iconoclasts, people that, Ralph Lauren would be an iconoclast, someone who is so creative and is just fulfilling their destiny, their potential. And as a result, their passion draws other people in to what they're doing, and you end up, in a sense, learning at the foot of the master.
Right. So all the people that you've named are obviously legends in their field. Yeah. It's sort of hard to think about an everyday manager mm-hmm. thinking, oh, I can do exactly what these people mm-hmm. do. So, what mm-hmm. advice do you give the executives right. that you counsel about how to be more like a super boss?
Right. Well, it could be daunting when you start reading about, Alice Waters and Bill Walsh and Ralph Lauren and say, boy, how am I ever going to accomplish that? But in fact, you can do all kinds of different things. And actually, in the book, in each chapter, I have a whole bunch of ideas as well. And so you're not necessarily going to become the genius super boss of that magnitude overnight. But what I've discovered is that anyone could become a super boss, can increase their super boss potential, if you will, or quotient, as I call it, and you can do that by adopting these practices in small order, learning as you're going along, developing these different capabilities. It turns out all of this is completely teachable.
Wow, terrific! Well, hopefully, we'll all become more super boss-like. Thank you so much for your time.
Great to be here with you, Allison.